sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see so clearly. Hallelujah, grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, all my sins are washed away. They're washed away. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieve. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Hallelujah, grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, all my stains are washed away, they're washed away, shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing your praise than when we first began. Grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, and all my stains are washed away. Hallelujah, grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, and all my stains washed away, they're washed away. Hallelujah, yeah. Hallelujah, yeah. Hallelujah, yeah. Hey, yeah. Stains are washed away, they're washed away.
Hey guys, my name's Jamie and I go to FBCN. I have a testimony to share with you guys tonight. My uncle was in an accident about a month ago. He was putting an addition on his house and he fell off the roof. They had to medevac him to the hospital, where they found that he had broke his neck and the vertebrae was putting pressure on his spinal cord. A few days later, he went into surgery and they were able to repair some of his neck, but he was diagnosed as being quadriplegic. He has a trach, which is a tube in your neck, and it's hooked up to a ventilator because he's losing the ability to breathe on his own. We went to see him last Sunday, and the first thing that he could verbalize to us, because he can't talk very well, he said to us, you know, through the trach, he said, "Is Jesus loves me a religious term?" And we were like, yeah, it's a religious term. And there's a song that goes with that, "Jesus Loves Me." And we asked him if he would want us to sing it to him. So he nodded his head, and we sang "Jesus Loves Me" to a 43-year-old man. And then after we sang "Jesus Loves Me," he said in a whisper, "Can you get it for me? I think it'll help me." And so tonight, we have some recording equipment, and I would like you guys with me to sing "Jesus Loves Me." But before I do that, I would like to challenge you guys tonight. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what's going to happen next week or next month. Make the choice for Christ tonight, you guys. You might not get another chance like this. So we're going to sing "Jesus Loves Me," okay? Are you guys ready? Okay, ready? What?
Jesus loves me, this I know.
Thank you, guys.
I'm starting. Oh, okay. All right, guys. Well, guess what? Where you guys at? Where you at? Yeah, okay, there you guys are. Anyways, welcome to Jesus Fest. Really glad you guys came. Listen. Good to see you all. I can't see any of you. There's this like haze in front of my face. Guys got to quit smoking. It's really bad for your health. But seriously though, guys, on the count of three, I'm going to ask you to yell at the top of your lungs what church you came from. All right, ready? What church you guys come from? Good work. I heard a Phoenixville at the end. That's way to get your shout out in right at the end. Everyone's quiet. All right, that's cool, because I really couldn't understand a word you guys say, but here's my question. Who are we here to worship tonight? See, man, that's what it's all about. We're here, we're just here to worship the Lord. So, the good thing is we got a drama here we want you guys to check out. So, drama team, come on up, and we're going to get this party started.
Against male teacher in Philadelphia strikes through the heart of
a flood took the lives of 600 people this week.
In a world full of tragic events, bad news, death, and destruction,
where is the hope?
What can we lean on?
Who will save us?
A baby was abandoned in his car by his mother this afternoon. Doctors were unable to save.
Two teenage boys brought guns into school today. The death count is up to 9 so far.
An unknown disease has killed 3 people already. Doctors are unsure of.
A bomb was found.
A threat was received.
The war in Iraq continues.
Where is the hope?
For God so loved the world that he gave his only son.
So that whoever believes him will not perish, but have everlasting life.
He said, come to me, all who are weary and carry heavy burdens.
And God, I will give you rest.
God did not send his son into the world to condemn it, but to save it.
In a world full of bad news, tragic events, death, and destruction,
there is hope.
There is a light.
For Jesus said, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, for I have overcome the world.
All right, guys, let's give them another quick round of applause. Thank you. Yeah. Okay. All right, listen, I need all you guys to stand up. And listen, as you guys are doing this next thing, this is a lot of fun. What I need you to do is turn around the people around you, give someone a Holy Ghost high five, which is just like this. Nice and easy, okay? As you guys are doing that, make sure you just kind of get to say hello to the people. There's a guy walking around from Eastern Nazarene College. He's got T-shirts, Frisbees. He'll kind of be throwing them out, whatever. So just be aware of flying objects. Anyways, make sure you say hello.
Straight.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Jesus Fest! Woo! It's wonderful to see all your smiling faces. It's so exciting to be here with our friends, with our family. But above all, it's exciting to be here with the Lord. As the scripture says that wherever he is praised, his presence is there. Amen. So if I'm going to ask all of you to stand, I'm going to lead us in a prayer, and then we're going to sing together. We're going to sing to the King tonight. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the awesome privilege it is to come into your presence. Lord, we thank you that you're alive, that you're working in our world. God, that you're working in our hearts. And Lord, that you say that we can come and we can have communion with you. We can worship you. So, Father, I pray that you would be honored and glorified here tonight. Lord, that our eyes would be open, that our hearts would be open, our ears would be open, Lord, to things that we had never even considered or thought of before. Because, God, that's how you work. So, Lord, I just lift up this time to you, and I pray that you would be magnified and glorified in all things. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's get those hands clapping.
For his returning, we watch and
We're going to sing for his returning. We watch and we wait.
For his returning, we watch and we pray.
We will be ready.
We will be ready. The dawn of the day. We'll join.
With this song, I'm going to ask that all the ladies in the audience follow me, and all the men follow Glenn and Dave, okay?
I will love you
all of my days.
splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. An age to age he stands, time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three and one, Father, Spirit, Son, Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the
the voices now. Let's hear the voices.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Say it again. Say it one more time.
How great. How great.
This is the last song we're going to do before Josh comes on. And this is an exciting song. Because before Jesus ascended into heaven, he says, I no longer call you servants, I call you friends. And we're here to declare tonight that we are friends of God. What an awesome privilege. That's right. That's a reason to rejoice. That we are friends of God. So let's sing this song together. those hands together.
Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? You hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing.
Sing friend of God.
'Cause I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. He calls me friend. He calls me friend.
You may be seated.
Wow. Wow. Isn't that awesome? Wow. One day in the presence of God in glory, we're going to worship Him every moment just like this. Amen. Amen. My name is Bill Bennett. the CEO and founder of Crossfire Ministries. And it's a privilege and an honor tonight to be partnering with Jesus Fest. It's certainly a privilege and an honor to be partnering with Josh McDowell Ministries, but ultimately it's a privilege and an honor to be partnering with our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Because tonight it's all about His glory and His honor. And I know that when Josh comes out tonight, he's going to share exactly from his heart what God will have him share with you and I. And I really believe that no one's going to leave this place tonight without being changed. Without being changed. I had the privilege of spending some time with Josh over this past week. Last weekend we had a youth worker summit down at Philadelphia Biblical University where he was the keynote speaker and led the opportunity there. He also spoke and did a parent seminar last Sunday. So we spent a lot of time together. And one of the things I want to say about Josh, God is using him in a mighty and a powerful way, not just in this community, not just in our country, but all across the world. And tonight, you're in for a treat. So buckle your seatbelts and be ready for a ride of your life. As we introduce to you, let's give him a good round of applause, Josh McDowell.
Thank you, guys. Good evening. Woo! Hey, can anyone tell me, did the Eagles win today? Oh, they did? No, they didn't. They didn't beat Denver. I'm sorry. I'll tell you this, if I couldn't be with my family tonight, right now, there's no place I'd rather be than right here. And I want to challenge your thinking tonight. And tonight, I'm not going to give a talk. What I'm going to do is share my heart as a daddy. I really wish tonight you could be my son, my daughter. I could be your dad. You could be my son, and we could sit down and have a Coke together and look each other in the eye and talk about this as I do with my kids. Now, one reason I want to do that, I've had the privilege of being married to the same woman for 34 years. Woo! I'll tell you, man. God created my wife, took one look and said, whoops, I overdid it. Then I have four, where's the PowerPoint? Where's the PowerPoint? Ah, bummer. Anyway, I got four kids. I've got a daughter who is a medical doctor, and she's in her second year. Can you imagine? 4 years of medical school, then 5 years of residency to be a child psychiatrist. She wants to work with young people that come from hurting homes. And I thank God for his call in her life. Then I've got a son who graduated from Talbot Seminary with a double master's. I can't imagine that, in ethics and philosophy and theology. And he's written three books. He's the head of a large Bible department at a Christian school and married his 11-year sweetheart and gave me 11 years, not 11-year-old, just so you understand. I mean, you know, we do have standards. And but thank God they provided me with my first grandson. And now let me tell you, it is marvelous. So what I did, one of the churches did this huge pit. Where's the PowerPoint? What? It's not working. Oh, bummer. Okay. Fix it. Okay. Well, if he can't, nobody can. I'll tell you that. But this one church did this. Yeah, you'll fix it. One church did this huge picture of me from about here up for promotion. So I said, can I take that? So I carried it all the way. I think it was like from New York to L.A. through four airports. And everybody looking saying, man, does that guy have an eagle problem? But I took it home and I gave it to my grandson. He's only like 18 months old. So when I talked to him on the phone, they put the picture out. And it's really neat. And almost every time now when I hang up, he goes over the picture and he kisses me. Yeah, he kisses me in the cheek. And look, my grandson, he looks just like me. It's unbelievable. I said, Scotty James, take a look at Grandpa. That's exactly, isn't that cruel? No, he looks more like this. Yeah, there we go. Yeah. But he goes over and kisses my picture right on the cheek. But tomorrow, I'm taking him to a Halloween party, and then we're going out trick-or-treating together, and so I'll get to hug him tomorrow. Then I've got a daughter who is 25 years old, graduated from Auburn University, met her husband at a Bible college in Europe. He's from Canada, and right now they're in the Advanced Guiding School of Canada because they want to use the Outback, mountain climbing, everything, to help inner-city kids to come to know Christ. And then I've got a daughter when she was 25 days old. We had the privilege of adopting her. She's Hispanic, so we all learned Spanish, so when she grew up, we could understand her. And but let me tell you, that's one expensive smile. That's 8 years of braces and worth every dollar. But I think it ought to be a federal law. Every family has to adopt. I'm serious. I'm a better person. I'm a more loving man because we had the privilege of adopting Heather. She's now a first-year student at Biola University, and Tuesday she's taking the day off, and she and I are going to the Marina in Dana Point, California, and we're just going to, as she says, we're going to bond all day. That means I get her nails, I pay to have her nails cut, pay to have her hair done, I pay for lunch. That's what it means, bonding. You know, dad pays, and that's okay. That's why God made dads. But tonight, I want to tell you a story. I want to tell you a story about an 11-year-old boy who woke up one morning, just wanted to die. He didn't want to live anymore. Have you ever been lonely? Have you ever felt like someone abandoned you? Have you ever felt like it wouldn't matter to anyone if you lived or died? That's how I felt at 11 years old. I was brought up in a farm near Union City, Michigan, a little town about 1800. My father was the town drunk. I hardly ever knew him sober until I was 20 years old. I'd go to high school, and my friends would come, and they'd make jokes about my father downtown in the gutter making a fool of himself. They didn't think it bothered me because I'm like some of you right here. You know who I'm talking about. You know who you are. Well, you can laugh on the outside when you're crying on the inside. Every time they told a joke about my dad, it hurt, but I never ever let anyone know. We lived in the farm, and I would go out to the barn at 8, 9, 10, 11 years old, and I see my mother, who I loved very much, lying in the manure in the gutter behind the cows where my father had yanked the milk hose off the milking machine and beat my mother to a bloody pulp until she was so weak she couldn't stand up. And all she could do was roll out of the manure onto the little sidewalk behind the cows over onto her back. And at 8, 9, 10, 11 years old, I'd be kicking my dad and pounding on him, just screaming, "When I'm strong enough, I'll kill you." We'd have friends over, and my dad would be drunk. Any of you that have an alcoholic parent, a number of you do, you know what I'm talking about. Trust me, if you don't have an alcoholic parent, you don't know what I'm talking about. You don't know the shame that you carry with you every day of your life, especially when friends come over and your dad or mom's drunk or on drugs. And so before friends would get there, I'd grab my dad. He was a very small man. I'd grab him around the neck, and I'd pull him out through the dirt or the snow to the barn, and I'd put him into the pen where the cows have their calves and drop him on the straw. Then I'd go, because you learn to drive young in the farm, and I'd pack the car out of the garage, park it up around behind the barn, leave the garage doors open, tell the friends he had to go away so we wouldn't be shamed. In case he woke up before they left, I'd go back out to the barn, I'd get down under him, and I'd work him up until he was up against the boards, and I'd put his arms to the boards like this and then tie a rope from one wrist to the other wrist. And then I'd go outside behind him, and I'd take a rope and make a hangman's noose, and I'd put it around his neck and tighten it, then I'd put it around his feet, and as a little kid, as tight as I could pull that, I would pull it to his head and went backwards all the way over that top board. And then I'd wrap around his feet and knot it, and I'd leave him there at 6 o'clock at night until 6 o'clock the next morning. And morning after morning, I'd go out there and he'd still be alive. I just wanted him dead. I wanted him to quit hurting my mother, and I couldn't stop him, and I felt guilty. 2 months before I graduated from high school, I came home from a date about midnight, walked into the farmhouse, and I heard my mother crying, just weeping, and it scared me. And I remember running through the farmhouse just yelling, "Mom, what's wrong? What's wrong?" And I ran into her bedroom. She sat up in bed just crying. And she said, "Son, your father has broken my heart." And then she reached down, put her arms around me, pulled me to her and said, "Son, I've lost the will to live. All I want to do is live until you graduate, then I just wanted to die." Boy, that was hard to hear. And you know what happened? You know the irony? 2 months later, 61 days later, I graduated from high school, and the next Friday, the 13th, my mother up and died. Don't tell me you can't die of a broken heart. My mother did. My father broke it, and I hated him for it. When I was 11 years old, the age of some of you here are just a little younger, my oldest brother Wilmot, I was one of five children. I was the youngest. My brother Wilmot was the oldest. Sued my parents in a court of law for everything they had. Now, I was only 11 years old. I didn't know what was going on, but I knew there was a problem. And one thing my brother got in the lawsuit, I found out later, was a new home my folks had built on a farm for workers. And he announced he was going to move it. And my parents went to him, I found out later, and said, Wilmot, leave the house. We need it. We'll buy you land. We'll buy you the house. We'll give you the money, whatever, but leave the house. We need it. But my father had so hurt my brother. My brother said, no, we're going to move it. Well, when they announced that Saturday, that in 2 weeks they were going to move that big house a mile and a half down in Union City, Michigan. Now, come on, I was 11 years old. My mind couldn't comprehend. No way. You're going to pick up that house and move it down in Union City, Michigan? For 2 weeks, it was like anticipating Disney World the first time. I couldn't sleep. And it came that Saturday morning. I got up extra early and did my chores, went back in, took about two showers, scrub off the manure smell, put on my best work clothes, slapped on some old spice, and ran out the back of the house. And I went to the porch, and outside the house was a little sidewalk that went around the back. And as I went around the corner of the house, you could look up, and you could see the house they were going to move. It was probably half again further than the width of this auditorium away from the main farmhouse. As I went around the corner of the house, I looked up there, and I saw this small group of people. There weren't very many. There were probably 30, 40 people. There were farmers from around Union City, Michigan. Many of them were merchants, stores that I went to at your age for a milkshake, a hamburger, school supplies. But many of these farmers and merchants were parents of my friends. Well, 11 years old, I thought, wow, this is going to be quite a party. I figured they couldn't believe you could move a house like that. Well, I found out real fast that's not why they were there. They were there because my older brother, who was very popular, knew my parents would stand in opposition to moving that house. So he went around and got these farmers and these merchants and many of them, parents of my friends, to come out that day and stand in opposition to my parents. Well, I didn't know that. Well, here I'm 11 years old, and I mean my adrenaline was flowing. I was so excited, and as fast as I could run up that little nowhere hill to that house, I was churning, and I got to the top of that knoll where the house was, and my world came crashing down. I heard these farmers, these merchants, these parents of my friends yell the dirtiest, filthiest names at my parents. And 11 years old, I couldn't handle it, and I snapped. It was like I hit a glass wall, and I lost part of my life. To this day, I don't know what happened. Even this last summer, I went back there. For the third time in my life, I went back to the farm, and I stood there. And this summer, I said, Lord, give me back my memory. I don't know if I lost 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, or what. I know it's there, but I can't unlock it. The only conscious thought I have is I was running down the other side of the hill towards the end of the barn where we had a room probably about the size of this right here. And there were places, there were three bins for wheat, oats, and shelled corn to grind up for feed. And I ran up the six steps, turn around, 11 years old, I slid that big door closed, put the big iron latch down, reached over, knocked out the blinders on the two windows, until it was absolutely pitch black. And then at 11 years old, I climbed into the corn bin and I buried myself up to my neck. And that's when I prayed to die. I didn't want to live anymore. I never wanted to go out in the light. Trust me, I never wanted to go to school again. But you know what really hurt at 11 years old? I never wanted to go to a friend's house again. That's what hurt. I was there for 3 hours and my parents never came looking for me. Ever felt alone? Ever felt abandoned? Ever felt like it wouldn't matter to anyone if you lived or died? That's how I felt at 11 years old, buried up to my neck in corn. And that's when I became an angry man. And young people, I have paid a price for that anger over my life. I became angry at my father because I believe my father had abandoned me, and he had. And I became angry at God, if he exists, because I believe he'd abandoned me in that corn bin. About 1 o'clock that afternoon, I was so hungry and thirsty. I was only 11 years old. and the chaff and the corn is in my eyes and my nose and my mouth. That I dug myself out of that corn, jumped out of the bin, went over and unlatched that door. And when I slid that big door open and that sunlight hit me in the face, it shocked me into reality. And at that moment, I started slamming the door in my father. I cursed my father and I damned my father. And I started slamming the door on God and I cursed God and I damned God for abandoning me. And for 7 years, I slammed that door and I blasphemed. I enrolled in university. After several weeks in university, I saw a small group of students and professors, and their lives were different. You've probably seen some people like this. They were a little different. They seemed to know where they were going in life. They seemed to have direction. You know what they really had all? You know what caught my attention? It's something you have everywhere, but I saw a different dimension of it. Here was a group of students and professors who loved and cared about each other. Now, you'll see that everywhere. Here was the difference. They also loved and cared for people outside their group. The way I was raised, that was weird, and I wanted it. Oh, I wanted it. So I made friends with these students and professors, and after a couple weeks, we're sitting around the table in the student union. Six of the students there, two of the professors, and the conversation started to get to God. Well, come on. If you're an insecure student, a professor, a businessman, or woman, and a conversation gets to God, you're insecure, you have to put on the big front. So I was putting on the big front, but they were irritating me. So I looked over at this young lady. Oh, she was a good-looking woman. I used to think all Christians were ugly. I did. I figured if you couldn't make it anywhere else in life, you became a Christian. But she was really cute, and that threw me for a loop. Now I had a problem. This was my problem. I wanted what they had, but I didn't want them to know that I wanted what they had. But all the time, they knew that I wanted what they had and didn't want them to know that I wanted what they had. So I leaned back in my chair, and I just tried to act totally nonchalant, like I could care less. And I looked over at this young lady, and I said, tell me, what changed your lives? Why are you so different? The other students and leaders on campus, why? What happened? I couldn't believe it. She looked back at me with a little smile, and that can be irritating. And she said two words I never thought I'd hear in university as part of the solution. She looked back at me and said, Jesus Christ. I said, oh, for God's sakes, don't give me that garbage. I'm sick and tired of religion, the church, the Bible, and I exploded. Only three times in my life have I lost my temper, and this was the first time, and I came unglued. About 5 years ago, a friend of mine asked, Why'd you get upset? Why'd you get mad? All they said was Jesus Christ. I said, I don't know, but I think for this reason. When I was 11 years old and I walked out of that corn bin, I stuffed that anger, young people, down into my life like some of you have. I stuffed it down in my life. And when they said Jesus Christ, it was like triggering a volcano. And all that anger of 7 years against God and my dad just erupted like a volcano. And I lit into them, but they stood in there with me. They didn't walk away. What would you have done? No, what would you have done this week? If at your school or somewhere, you said, Jesus Christ, somebody just lit into you, how many of you would walk away? Say, well, in an attitude like that, I know where you're going. Do you want smoking or non-smoking? Or would you hang in there with them? They hung in there with me. And this young lady shot back. And she said, mister, I didn't tell you religion, tell you church. I told you the person of Jesus Christ. I apologized to her. I apologized to all of them because my mother had not raised me to be rude. But I'm probably the only person ever attached a disclaimer to an apology. I said, I'm sorry, but I'm sick and tired of religion, church, the Bible, and I don't want anything to do with it. Then I couldn't believe it. Right there in the university, these students and professors had the gall to challenge me, now get this, as a pre-law student, to use my mind to intellectually examine the claims of Jesus Christ as God's son, now get this, and the Bible being true, to do that intellectually. I thought that was a joke. I thought Christians had two brains. One was lost, and the other was out looking for it. I really believed. If a Christian had a brain, it'd die in isolation. Well, they just kept challenging me. No, no, no. They ticked me off. They made me so mad and I was so angry. I said, okay, I'll accept your challenge. I'll accept your challenge, but I didn't do it to prove anything. I did it to refute them. One, I was going to show that God abandoned me in that corn bin when I was 11 years old. Second, it's not up here, I set out to write one of the books I'm probably most known for around the world called Evidence That Demands a Verdict. That huge gold one out there. The whole background of that book was to write it against Christianity. I figured any fool could do that, and I'd qualify. So I left the university, and I traveled throughout the United States, England, Germany, France, and the Middle East to gather the evidence to prove that Jesus Christ was a mere man and the Bible was just myth. I was sitting in a small museum library in London, England. It was a Friday night, about 6:30. And boy, I'd never done this before. I leaned back in my chair and I cupped my hands behind my head. And right in front of everyone, which was probably three people, I said, "It's true! It's true! It's true!" Now, what I meant by that was a reference to the New Testament. Not that it was a word of God. Come on, folks. I wasn't even close to that. But as an obnoxious, antagonistic, agnostic university student, I concluded two things were true about the New Testament part of the Bible. One, I concluded as a non-believer, I could hold the New Testament in my hand and say what I have today is what was written down 2,000 years ago. It has not been changed. Don't you let anyone come along. Don't you let a Muslim, anyone else tell you that the Christians came along and changed it. That's an absolute lie. Second thing I concluded is not only with the New Testament that what I have is what was written down, but this is more important, that what was written down was true. My mother didn't raise any dummies. Because look, if what was written down wasn't true, then I could care less that what I have today is what was written down. I'm not an idiot. And I concluded it was true in this. It was true that Jesus said this, not that what he said was true. That's another issue. But it was true that he said it, and it was true that Jesus did that. I'm so glad God didn't give up on me. He still pursued me. I don't think anyone can approach God except God draws you. I really don't. And God was drawing me and loving me. Because he had to, and I started to say, okay. If it's true, just if it is true, then what does it say? If the Bible is true, what does it say? Oh, men and women, this is when, as a total non-believer, I discovered in the Old Testament, first of all, in Exodus 34:14, most of your translations will say this, you shall worship no other God but the Lord, for he is a God who is jealous. Do you know what that jealous means there? Listen to this. You shall worship no other God but the Lord, for he is a God who is passionate. That's what jealous means. He is passionate about his relationship with you. I said, wait a minute. God, you're saying that if you are, that you are passionate about a relationship with me? Where were you when I was in the corn bin? And I exploded. It was the second time in my life I lost my temper and I came unglued. If he was passionate, then why? Where was he in the corn bin? In about 45 minutes, I got calmed down thanks to a couple Christians. And God was still working. I said, okay, God, if it's true, and if you are passionate about a relationship with me, then what will it look like? What will it look like? Oh, men and women, y'all, this is when I, you with me, guy? This is when I, look at me in the eye, there you go. This is when I discovered the love of God. I wasn't even a believer, girls. In fact, I was an obnoxious unbeliever. And I discovered four things about God's love. Four things. One, that God's love takes the initiative. Well, the Bible says this in his love. Not that we loved him, but that he loved us. Second thing I learned about God's love is that it's sacrificial. Boy, that was a new twist. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. The third thing I learned about God's love is that it's all-knowing. In Psalm 139, it says this in the first few verses. He knows everything about you. For there's a word upon your lips, you know, he knows it. And when you lie down, rise up from afar, he knows it. You know one of the problems I had? As a student in university, as I started, a little graduate start to say, you know, God probably is. And the Bible's true, and Christ is the Son of God. As I started to lean towards that, there was a fear that developed in my life. And this was the fear. I had a fear that if God really knew me, he would never love me. He would never love me because I was angry. I had a lot of anger in my life, and I damned God. But you know what I found out? Before I ever became a Christian, I learned the Gaither Trio wrote a song in this that says, I am loved, I am loved. He who knows me best loves me most. I discovered that as a non-Christian. The fourth thing I learned about God's love is that it's all-encompassing. Come on, you've all read this probably. You with me there, lady? You probably read this. In John 15:9, Jesus said, now you got to think this through, young lady. Jesus said, just as God the Father loves the Son. Now think of this. Jesus said, as much as the Father loves the Son, Jesus said, I love you. Whoa. I said, wait, just a minute now. God, you're trying to say that if you aren't, Jesus Christ is your Son, that as much as you love him, you love me, and that caused a crisis. He said, no, come on, Josh, you're an obnoxious university student, and you're starting to conclude it's true that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the Bible's true, and that caused a crisis? Yes. The crisis was this. Is it true? Is it true? Or did I so want to be loved? I was willing to be psychologically manipulated into believing anything. Or did I so want to know I wasn't abandoned in that corn bin? That I'd believe anything? Because I concluded, if Jesus Christ is not the Messiah, the Son of God, then hear me, y'all. Love is not real, and neither is forgiveness. And I concluded, if he was the Son of God, then I would follow him the rest of my life with every breath that I breathe. But if I discovered he wasn't, I would walk away and never turn back.
He totally just walked away.
What?
In the middle of speaking, Josh McDowell totally just stopped talking and walked away.
Hold on, I'm just writing down the last thing he was saying.
Hey, I didn't sleep through his talk, did I?
Yeah, you did. You know, I would think if you want to get something out of this, you would pay just a little bit more attention.
Haven't you ever heard of subliminal learning?
Oh, Liz, cut it out. I just don't want you to miss anything, that's all.
I'm not missing the important things.
Well, maybe not, but those who are want to become a true Christian and a true follower of Christ can't really hear over your snoring.
Wait, a true follower of Christ? You mean me?
Really? I mean, you're a true follower of Christ?
Yeah, I mean, I know I go for it every year, but last time I totally meant it. I mean, I've given my life to Christ, and I really feel great. I mean, I feel it this time. I really feel it.
Excuse me, I don't mean to be eavesdropping or anything, but you are wearing microphones.
No problem. I'm Becca, and this is Liz.
Cody, look, I don't mean any disrespect by this, but do you really think you should be basing your entire belief system on just what you feel?
What else am I gonna base it on?
Oh, Liz, haven't you been listening? This is what we believe in. You know, this is what God says, and it's true. And it's not just that we feel good about it.
But it feels awesome. It totally rules! I mean, Jesus has changed my life, and I sense that it totally rules.
Yeah, but you do realize that you're saying your life has been completely changed by this man who died over 2,000 years ago.
Well, we believe that Jesus has the power to transform a life today, even 2,000 years after he rose again.
What she said, in your face, Cody.
Again, no disrespect, but it just seems a little far-fetched to me that this man or prophet or whatever you want to call Jesus has the power to impact a life this long after his own.
Well, he couldn't. I mean, he can't. If he isn't God.
God? You're saying he was God.
Yeah, totally God in your face. Feel that?
Liz, we're saying he's God. Right now, he's God and he's alive. And he's the one that came and saved us. And he changed our lives.
Right, but that's just what you think. It's just what you feel.
It is what I believe and it's what I think. But it's true whether anyone believes it or not.
Okay, I admire your conviction on that one, but you know that does put you in a pretty tough spot.
It does?
How's it put us in a tight spot?
Well, you see, you're risking everything on whether Jesus was God or not. And I mean, if he was, then what you said about him changing your life, you know, that's good and all. But if he wasn't, then what you think you experienced isn't real at all.
It's not?
It is. It is real, Liz. We've got the evidence.
Yeah, she doesn't seem so sure, Becca. How convincing can that evidence be?
Oh, we're in trouble.
No, we're not in trouble, Liz. You just don't have a handle on it yet. That's all. You know, let's just look at some evidence, okay?
Imagine you are given a goose that lays golden eggs. Scrap that. A magical guitar. No, an enchanted hummer. And you are told that if you drive that enchanted hummer, you will be more attracted to girls and you will be able to rocket to the moon. Now you can believe and believe and believe in that enchanted hummer and that it will bring you the chicks and a lunar experience. But if it doesn't deliver, then it must not be true.
Must not be true.
It doesn't matter how much you believe it. If it proves to be false, it is false, right?
Right.
But what about the flip side? If something can be proven absolutely true to actually accomplish the amazing things it says it will do, then it must be real.
Must be real.
Whether you believe it or not.
I guess so.
You guess so?
Absolutely.
Let's say, for instance, Jesus Christ is the Son of the one true God, the only way to God.
I don't believe that.
But have you weighed all the evidence?
Evidence? Who needs evidence? All I need is to believe in what I believe.
But believing doesn't make what you believe true. And if it's not true, what you believe can't be real.
Can't be real!
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah.
It's all a part of the evidence.
That's when
my attitude changed.
Are you hearing that too? No, no. That's when my attitude changed. From being antagonistic to refute it, to I really believe, young people, I became an honest inquirer. Not to prove it true, not to prove it false, but just to examine the evidence and ask the question, is it true, and let the chips fall. But oh, I never dreamed. I never dreamed. Especially when I was your age and older, that there was so much evidence. Let me show you what I mean. That's why it took me, after I came to Christ, to write this book right here. This one I was talking about. It's a huge one. Just got selected as 100 most influential books of the last century. And I set out to write this against Christianity. After I came to Christ, I spent 13 years documenting the evidence of why it's true. I never knew there was so much. And what I want to do, I want to share with you just one little piece of it. Just one little piece. But you're going to have to give me your minds or you will miss it. If you don't think this through with me, you will miss it. It's something Jesus appealed to. In Luke 24, Jesus went to his disciples and he said, guys, don't you get it? You know, they didn't get it. And Jesus said, no, give me your minds. You with me there, young lady? Think through me with your mind. Jesus said, everything that is written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. What Jesus did was this. In the Old Testament, there's 333 prophecies about who the coming Messiah would be, all fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And Jesus appealed to them. These prophecies were all written down 500 years before Christ was born. I had a professor say to me, I don't think that happened. I don't think these prophecies were even written down after Jesus was born. Then they wrote them out to make it look like they were fulfilling his life. I said, well, that sounds pretty good, unless you want to think. I said, sir, the Septuagint, don't let that big word throw you. The Septuagint Now get this, is the Greek title given to the Greek translation of the Hebrew Testament. You with me, young lady? They took the Old Testament and they translated into Hebrew, and all the prophecies were translated into Hebrew, into Greek, and they called it the Septuagint. I said, sir, history confirms the Septuagint was completed over 200 years before Christ was even born. I said, you don't have to have the whole loaf sliced to realize. If 200 years before Christ you have the prophecies, you got the same problem if you say it's not 500 years. And all these were fulfilled in Christ. I really believe that in many ways God gave these prophecies for people like me and people like some of you there who are skeptical and you need something concrete. In fact, as a non-believer, I looked at these prophecies as God writing an address. That's right, to identify a son. Remember, buddy, past, present, future. Do you know your address separates you from 6.5 billion people alive? Even if it's general delivery, it's separate. In the same way, God wrote an address to identify his son, and he did it through prophecy. Now, I want to relate just a small number, just a handful of these prophecies. Now, here's the problem. I am going to talk faster than you have probably ever had heard anyone talk, especially in Pennsylvania. I am going to rival an auctioneer. I'm going to. If you want all the facts and documentation, it's in that book, The New Evidence That Demands a Verdict. Now, you're going to have to listen fast or you will miss it. Here's God writing an address to identify his son. Now, realize I could do this with all 333 prophecies. I'm only going to do it with a small handful. Let's go all the way back forward a quarter time in Genesis 3:15. God said the first indication of the Messiah would be, he'd be born of the seed of the woman. Everybody else in the Bible is referred to the seed of the man except for the Messiah. Why? The virgin birth. Then we go down to recorded time. Noah had more than just a boat. He had three kids, Ham, Shem, and Japheth. Do you realize every nation in the world can be traced back to one of these three individuals? Now God eliminates 2/3 of the nation in the world when he says that my son will not only be the seed of the woman, but the lineage of Shem. Now in the lineage of Shem, God called a man out of the earth of the Chaldees in the name of Abraham. And he said, now you can know who my son is because he'd be born in the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, and the descendants of Abraham. Now, Abraham had 8 children. Now, God eliminates 7/8 of the descendants of Abraham when he says that my son will not only be of the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, the descendants of Abraham, but the line of Isaac. Now, Isaac had 2 children, Jacob and Esau. Now, God eliminates 50% of the line of Isaac. Any of you who've ever studied math in high school will see the phenomenal probability building up historically. When God says that my son will be of the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, descendants of Abraham, line of Isaac, line of Jacob, the line of Isaac, and the line of Jacob. Now, Jacob had 12 children, out of which developed the 12 tribes of Israel. In Genesis 49:10, God eliminates 11/12 of the tribes of Israel. When he says, my son will not only be of the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, descendants of Abraham, line of Isaac, line of Jacob, but of the tribe of Judah. And when the tribe of Judah, there are many family lines. Isaiah 11:1, God eliminates every single family line but one. When he says, my son will be of the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, descendants of Abraham, line of Isaac, line of Jacob, tribe of Judah, but of the family of Jesse. Now Jesse had 8 children. Now God eliminates 7/8 of the family line of Jesse. When he says, my son will be of the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, descendants of Abraham, line of Isaac, line of Jacob, tribe of Judah, family of Jesse, but of the house of David. Then we go down to about 1012 BC with a very unusual prophecy in Psalm 22, where God says, you can identify my son because he'd be born of the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, descendants of Abraham, line of Isaac, line of Jacob, tribe of Judah, family of Jesse, house of David, be crucified, his hands and feet pierced against a tree. Somebody says, look, thousands of people were crucified. I said, that's right, but that method of crucifixion, young ladies, was not put in until 800 years after the prophecy. Then God narrows it down further. In one day, 29 prophecies were fulfilled in Christ. Here's 7 of them in Psalm 41, Zechariah 11. God says, you can identify my son because he'd be born of the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, descendants of Abraham, line of Isaac, line of Jacob, tribe of Judah, family of Jesse, house of David, be crucified, betrayed by a friend, 30 pieces, not 29.99, ladies, 30 pieces of silver, not gold, 4th would be thrown on the floor, not placed on the table, 6th would be in the temple, 7th would be used to buy a barrel of plot. Then God narrows it down further. Micah 5:2 eliminates every single city in the world but one for his own entrance in humanity. When he says that my son will be of the seed of the woman, lineage of Shem, descendants of Abraham, line of Isaac, line of Jacob, tribe of Judah, family of Jesse, house of David, be crucified, betrayed by a friend, 30 pieces of silver, thrown on the floor, in the temple, used to buy a barrel of plot, but his entrance in humanity will be in that little tiny city of Bethlehem Ephrata. Less than 1,000 people even lived there when the prophecy was made. And then God narrows it down further.
A professor said to me, you think if God was that smart, he could have told you when it would happen. I said, he did in Malachi 3:1. You might call it Malachi, but in Malachi 3:1, God says, you could know who my son is because he'd be born of the seed of the woman, lean sin, descendants of Abraham, land of Isaac, land of Jacob, tribe of Judah, family of Jesse, house of David, be crucified, betrayed, by a friend, 30 piece, substitute, thrown for him, in a temple used to buy a burial plot, and his entry in humanity, be in a little city, tiny Bethlehem, and it all happened before the destruction of the Jewish temple in Jerusalem. When did that happen? 70 A.D., 333 prophecies written down over 500 years before Christ was born, all fulfilled in Christ. And another man said to me, it's all a coincidence. I said, a coincidence? He said, yes. I said, Dr. Peter Stoner, in his book Science Speaks, using the modern science of probability, figured out the probability of only 8, not 333 of these, just 8 of the prophecies being fulfilled in any one individual. And the American Scientific Affiliation checked out his statistics and said he was scientifically accurate. And what it came out to be is 1 in every 1 times 10 to the 17th power. 1 in every quadrillion possibility. This is what it will look like.
How do you know what's true is really true?
That's where the evidence comes in. Christ's offer to turn you into a new person is real if his claim to be God is true. So let's consider the evidence of 8 prophecies proving his claim is true. Do you know what the probability factor is of only 8 prophecies being fulfilled in Jesus?
No.
1 in 10 to the 17th power.
1 in 10 to the 17th power.
Huh?
That's 1 in 10 to this many times.
I don't get it.
If you were to take 10 to the 17th power Girl Scout Thin Mint cookies.
How many?
That's over a quintillion cookies. And spread them across the state of Texas.
Yeehaw!
They would cover every inch of the state and form a pile of Girl Scout Thin Mint cookies 2 feet deep.
That's a lot of Thin Mints.
A whole lot of Thin Mints.
Now take 1 more Thin Mint and lick all the chocolate off, toss it into that pile, and stir the whole thing up. Blindfold yourself, walk the entire state from Amarillo to Laredo, stopping just once to stoop down and pick a single blind Thin Mint cookie.
Got it.
Take off the blindfold.
Aw, nuts.
The chances of you picking the chocolate-less cookie is the same as the chance that one person could have fulfilled just 8 prophecies about Jesus in 1 lifetime.
That's crazy.
It's unthinkable. But Jesus Christ did not fulfill 8 prophecies in 1 lifetime.
Whoa.
He fulfilled over 300.
300, girl!
Whoa.
And 29 of them in just 1 day. The prophecies are historically documented. The facts that actually happened to Jesus are historically documented. There's only 1 thing left to do.
I know. For me to weigh the evidence.
It's all part of the evidence.
Because if it is true that he is the Son of God, what he offers you, a new life in him, is real.
Now I know it's real, whether I believed it or not.
It's all part of the evidence.
Oh, yeah.
Because he is real.
That's when, for the first time in my life, I stated, it is true, I am loved. For God became man, and his name is Jesus. That is real. It is relevant, and it is true. And that led to a conflict in my life, to accept it or to reject it. Because I was convinced, young people, the Bible was true. I've debated that in universities all over the world. I knew the Bible was true, and I knew the Bible said, but to as many as received him, to them gave you the right to become a child of God. I used to think just going to church made you a Christian. Just going to church doesn't anymore make you a Christian. Walking into McDonald's makes you a Big Mac. It doesn't work that way. I found out I needed to exercise my will and place my trust in Christ as Savior Lord. So when I returned to the university from trying to write that book against Christianity,
I became a Christian. Somebody said, how do you know? I was there. It changed my life. I got alone with a friend of mine. I made sure my other friends weren't watching. I was a coward. And I prayed four things that literally transformed my life in a God who became man, and his name was Jesus. The first thing I prayed was, Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. The most humbling thought I've ever had to this day was as a non-believer when I realized if I were the only person alive, Jesus still would have died for me. Most people think I came to Christ through the intellectual route because of the debates I've done all over the world and the books I've written. But men and women, all the books that I've written, 97 of them, with all the documentation, none of that brought me to Christ. None of it did. All it did was show me that it was true. Once I was convinced it was true, then I considered its message. What brought me to Christ was the love of God. When I realized he would have gone through all of that just for me. I want to show you a video clip. We had permission from Mel Gibson to use this clip a long time before it came out in the theaters. And the first time we used it was in a huge arena with about 6,000 students out. I sat over to the side of the auditorium, and as this clip I'm going to show you came on, I started to cry. And I couldn't stop crying because it hit me. What you're going to see, I realized, if I were the only person on the face of the earth, Jesus still would have gone through this. Now, as we show you this clip, it's about 3.5-4 minutes long. I want every one of you to realize, young ladies, that Jesus would have done this just for you and you and you and you and me. Let's go to the clip of The Passion of the Christ by Mel Gibson.
Thank you.
Second, I said, I confess I'm a sinner. I knew the Bible was true, and the Bible said, for all have sinned. All you had to do was spend a day with me. I knew there were things in my life incompatible with a holy, just, righteous God. And I knew the Bible said, wow, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us. So I said, Lord Jesus, forgive me. I accept your forgiveness. Third, I said, right now, the best way I know how. And I knew the Bible said, but to as many as received him. So I said, I receive you into my life. I accept you as my personal Savior and Lord. I place my trust in you. The last thing I prayed was something like, just thank you. And nothing happened. Nothing. Wasn't any bolt of lightning. I didn't rush out and buy a harp. Well, something did happen. Almost instantly, I felt like I was going to vomit. I thought I was going to chuck my cookies. Oh, I hear these people say they came to Christ and are overwhelmed with joy and everything. I came to Christ and I wanted to throw up. And I think for two reasons. One, I remember having this thought, Josh, have you made an emotional decision you will later regret intellectually? And that scared me. But more than that, I was afraid of what my friends would say. I didn't have the faith in to understand that most of my friends would end up coming to Christ. Somebody had to come first. Well, I was the hardest nut to crack. And then after that, just one after another came to Christ. But I didn't know that at the time that I made that decision. And I just said, thank you for dying on the cross for me. In about 6 months, a year, year and a half, my entire life was transformed. I just want to share one area to close with. It's an area I'm not proud of. I'm ashamed of. It relates to my father. I hated my father. I despised everything that my dad stood for. I just wanted him dead so he would quit hurting my mother. When I was the age of many of you, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 years old, I don't think I ever went to bed that I didn't plot my father's death, how I could kill him without being caught by the police. But after I made that decision to place my trust in Christ as Savior and Lord, the same decision I'm going to ask you to make. I want you to think about that. I'm going to ask you to make that same decision that I was asked to make as a student. And the reason is because, one, God loves you, and he's passionate about a relationship with you, and I care about you. And after I made that decision to place my trust in Christ as Savior and Lord, the love of God through Jesus Christ came into my life. And I took that hatred and turned it upside down. And I found myself looking my father right in the eyes and say, Dad, I love you. That scared me. I didn't want to love my dad. I didn't. Even as a new Christian, I chose by an act of my will to hate the man who had killed my mother and destroyed my family. My one sister committed suicide. My other brother ran away from home and hasn't come back yet years later. My other brother sued my parents for everything they had. It wasn't a very functional family, folks. But I found myself saying to the man I chose to hate, I love you. That's when I knew it was real. I wasn't used to that. I was used to loving those I wanted to love and hating those I wanted to hate. I wasn't accustomed to loving those I chose to hate. That's when I knew I'd been born again. That's when I knew I'd gone into God's family. I transferred to Wheaton College. I was in a serious car accident. When they took me out of the hospital, they called my father. He was drunk, so he thought I was dying. I wasn't. I was just hurting a lot. They took me 127 miles home in an ambulance. They took me into the farmhouse, into my room. They strapped me in there with steel all over my body. I couldn't move my head or anything. All I could do was flash my eyes. And I could hear the ambulance leave. And in about 5 minutes, my father walked into that room. And all I could do was flash my eyes to look at him. And one, he was sober. But second, he was crying. I had never, ever seen my father cry. The only emotion I'd ever seen in my father when he got angry at my older brother Wilmot or my mother. And he didn't say anything. Here I am strapped in bed like this. And he just walks alongside the bed. Paced back and forth. Probably no more than 3-4 minutes when you're strapped in bed. It seems like eternity. And all of a sudden, my father just stopped. He was just crying. And he leaned right over my face, just like this. And he said, son, how can you love a father such as I?
I said, Dad, 6 months ago, I despised you. I hated everything that you stood for. But then I said, Dad, I've learned something, that God became man, and his name is Jesus, and he is passionate about a relationship with you. 45 minutes later was one of the greatest joys of my life. My own father said to me, son, if God could do in my life what I've seen him do in yours, I want to give him the opportunity. And right there, my father prayed with me. He prayed a very down-to-earth prayer. As best I can recall, this is what he prayed. God, if you're God and Christ is your son, and if he died on the cross for me, what we saw in the video, and if you can forgive me for what I've done to my family, and if you can do in my life what I've seen you do in the life of my son, then I accept you as my Savior and Lord. Come into my life. I place my trust in you. Forgive me. Well, my life was changing about 6 months, a year, year and a half, and still areas being changed. The life of my father was changed right before my eyes. It was like somebody reached down and turned on a light bulb. Now, don't get me wrong. I never saw it before. I've never seen it since. Usually the change takes place over a number of months or a year or two. But my daddy only touched alcohol once after that. He was a wino to the core. He drank for so heavy for so many years. 3/4 of his stomach had to be removed, cut out, and his entire liver was destroyed. But in that 14-month period before he died, over 100 men and women in that little tiny town surrounding area committed their lives to Jesus Christ because of the changed life of the town drunk, my daddy. I've come to one conclusion. I've come to one conclusion with deep convictions that God became man and his name is Jesus, and he is passionate about a relationship with you. There were many years that I never believed that, but I thank God someone introduced me to Jesus Christ. I want to ask you a question. I only want you to answer to yourself. Do you know Christ personally? You say, well, I think so. Then you probably don't. You say, well, I hope so. Then you probably don't. Well, I believe so. Then you probably don't. Look, folks, if you know Jesus Christ personally, you know that you know Jesus Christ personally. That's why the Bible says that you might know. Christianity is not a religion. Don't you believe what a lot of your peers believe, that you work your way to heaven? Absolutely not. That's religion. Religions, men and women trying to work their way to God, that's not Christianity. Christianity is a God who is passionate about a relationship with you and me. It's God coming to us and offering a relationship. There's at least 45 to 50 of you sitting there. And you're thinking like this, Josh, I'd like to know Christ. I'd like to know that I'm forgiven. I'd like to know that if I were to die today, where I'd spend eternity. I'd like to know that Christ lives in my heart. You can. I'm going to do for you what Jerry did for me in university. I'm going to pray out loud the prayer that I prayed to place my trust in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. And maybe the prayer that I prayed would help you right where you're sitting to express that very desire right now. I don't ask you to close your eyes. I don't ask you to bow your heads. Because years ago I learned the key to prayer is not in the position of the body, but the attitude of the heart. You can't give God a snow job. You can't fool him. This is a prayer that I pray, maybe just right now quietly in your own heart. It'll help you to express that very desire. I pray, Lord Jesus, I need you. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. Forgive me and cleanse me. Right this moment, I place my trust in you as Savior and Lord. I accept your forgiveness. Come into my life. Make me the person you created me to be. Many of you just sincerely prayed that prayer with me. If you did, and you want to know that Jesus Christ lives in your heart, you want to know if you were to die today where you'd spend eternity, and most of all, you want to know you're forgiven, then in just a moment, I'm going to ask you to do something that I was asked to do. I was scared to death when I was a student. I'm going to ask you to do what I was doing. In just a moment, I'm going to ask you to just stand up, just like I was asked. I'm going to ask you to make your way out into the aisles and go right through those two doors right back there. It won't take very long, but I'll guarantee you this. I don't think I've ever had one person in 40-some years ever regret doing it. I want some things shared with you that was shared with me that totally made a difference in my life. And so in just a moment, if you prayed that prayer with me like many of you did, and you want to know that Christ lives in your heart, you want to know you're forgiven, you want to know if you were to die today where you'd spend eternity, then just a moment, I'm going to ask you to just stand up right where you are. No music, anything. And make your way into the aisles and go right through those two doors back there. There's some of you guys sitting there and your palms are sweaty. You just prayed that prayer and you know you can't move. Say, how do you know, Josh? I've been there and I got a t-shirt to prove it. I was in a little meeting, no more than maybe like the first three rows right there. And the speaker gave an invitation like this, and I just prayed the prayer like you just did, and I was sincere. And I couldn't move. Nobody responded. Not one person responded. And I sat there, and I couldn't move. And it was just at the end of it, just going to close. And a friend of mine, Larry Miner, leaned over to me. Guys, all he said to me was, Josh, would you like me to go with you? Boom, I was right out of that seat right down front. I'll admit it, I needed someone to trigger my faith. I needed someone who loved me enough, who didn't pressure me, but he expressed love. Josh, do you want me to go with you? He died in a head-on car accident 3 months after that. I really believe, men and women, I was touched by an angel. I really believe that God sent Larry Miner to this earth to say, Josh, would you like me to go with you? So in just a moment, if you just prayed that prayer with me, and you were sincere, and you want to know that you're forgiven, you want to know that Christ lives in your heart, then in just a moment, I'm going to ask you to turn to a friend and say, Jim, Janet, Bob, Joyce, Richard, will you go with me? Will you go with me? There's nothing more beautiful than two guys going together, two girls, a boyfriend, a girlfriend, a father, a daughter, a mother, a daughter, a father, a son, a youth pastor with a youth. There's nothing more beautiful. I was sharing this in a huge arena, and right at this point, a guy jumps up over there, almost runs right straight across in front of me while I'm speaking, goes way to the end, to the next to the last guy, walked up to the guy, never said a word. The guy in the chair jumped up. They threw their arms around each other and walked out together. I thought, oh, if everyone had someone who had a relationship and a love like that, would you like me to go with you? So right now, if you just prayed that prayer with me, and many of you did, and you were sincere, and you want to know that Christ lives in your heart, you want to know you're forgiven, then right now I want you to turn to a friend and say, will you go with me? And stand up right now. Right now. Stand up right where you are right now. And make your way right out through here right now. Turn to a friend and say, will you go with me? Ask a friend to come with you. Tonight, I place my trust in Christ as Savior and Lord. Turn to a friend and ask them to come with you. Josh, I prayed that prayer with you. I was sincere. I want to know that Christ lives in my heart. I want to know I'm forgiven. Then step out right now. Ask a friend to come with you. If you don't have a friend to turn to, Christ comes with you all the time. Stand up right now. Don't hesitate. Every time I do this, just my mind is flooded with all the images. Folks, I was so scared. I thought I was going to wet my pants. I'm serious. I don't think I could have responded if Larry hadn't turned to me and just said, Josh, would you like me to go with you? Because if I hadn't responded, I wouldn't have been grounded in the faith that I just exercised. Step out right now. Ask a friend to come with you. Tonight, I place my trust in Christ as Savior and Lord. I want to know I'm forgiven. I'm going to ask this. This has been a phenomenal response. If you're a youth pastor and you can counsel, I've got to ask you to step out, please. This is too important. I believe the next few minutes in every one of their lives is the most critical minutes of the rest of their lives. If there's any of you that can counsel, would you step out right now, please? Thank you. Thank you. Step out right now. It won't take long, but and you're going to have to take the initiative in there. The gentleman leading it is called Ward Coleman. He's one of the greatest men you will ever meet in your life. I'll tell you this, folks. This Ward Coleman, of all the people I know in the world, there's not one person I'd rather have, I trust more, to be in that meeting right now than that man. You ought to be in there. It's unbelievable. Those kids will instantly love this man. I can't explain it. It's just, it's thrilling. And the way he explains it to them, and they just take it in. And afterwards, it'll be lined up for him to individually pray with them, and they'll want a hug from him. And it's marvelous. I take very seriously someone making a decision for Christ, because I believe in that 20 minutes after you make that decision, it's probably the most critical 20 minutes you'll ever have in your life, because if you don't get it solidified, then you often won't. Outside there you saw some of the resources. This is the book I was talking about, The New Evidence That Demands a Verdict. I wish every high school student, I wish every college student had a copy of this. Almost every question you will ever be confronted with apart from creation is answered right in there. And the university professors say more speeches have been given out of this book and more papers written than any other book in history except for the Bible. And professors can always say, well, I know that was out of evidence. You know why? The papers are always documented. They don't have to quote me. It's all documented. And then, one of my all-time favorite books that won every award out there is Don't Check Your Brains at the Door. This one here, I took 42 myths that people like you have about Christianity. You think it's true, but it's a myth. 42 different areas, I explode the myth, and then in language that a young person understands, I build the truth up. This will take so much doubting away and hesitancy about belief. Don't Check Your Brains at the Door. And then, one of my all-time favorites, The Youth Devotion, number 2, On Truth. Young people, I'd like to spend a year with you as a father. In fact, just give me 10 minutes a day, only 70% of your days, and I will guarantee you, in 1 year, you'll not only be thinking differently, you'll be acting differently. And this can be accomplished through this. That's how it was designed. There's other resources out there. If they will help you, it'll make all this gray hair worthwhile. Somebody says, you ought to diet. I said, no way. I worked hard for this. Thank you for the privilege of being in your area. Now, when I walked out here, the Eagles were one touchdown behind. It was 28-21. Anybody know what the answer is? You don't know? Where's my road hog? He doesn't know out there? We'll get it back to you. They'll probably lose, though. But let me tell you, the New York Giants beat the Redskins 36-0. Poor Joe Gibbs. Oh, he better go back to NASCAR. But I'm going to, tonight, I'm going over to the airport, sleep in my bus. I have a tour bus. And tomorrow morning, I'm flying nonstop to Orange County and see my little Scotty James, my grandson, and see my wife, see her first. She always comes first. And then have 5 days off. But thank you for the privilege of letting me be here with you. God bless.
Let's hear it again for Josh McDowell. Josh, where are you? Are you hiding back there? Praise God, that was absolutely amazing. It was awesome. Wow. Well, I'm going to ask you to remain standing. I want to sing some songs together. And, wow. Praise God. This song is really apropos of a lot of stuff that Josh was talking about, how God is passionate about having a relationship with us. And I think it's absolutely impossible to comprehend how deep and how vast the Father's love is. But even if we can think about it and grab a hold of it just a little bit, it's so overwhelming. And let's think about that.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He would give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away. Bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice cry
if you have anything on your heart that you want to pray about. It's a great place to pray. they'll be open for you to do whatever.
Oh, heart of mine, why must you stray from one so fair? You've run away, and one more time you have to pay the heaviness of needless shame. Oh, heart of mine, come back home. You've been too
Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this time of worship. God, and as we sing this one last song, this altar song, God, I know that so much has gone on in my life this week, and I know that so much has gone on in the hearts of everyone in this room, and I have to be constantly reminded to surrender it, to give it up to you, because I know that your plans and your will for my life is so much greater and more wonderful than I can ever imagine. So God, I just thank you. And as we sing this next song, help me personally to surrender to your will. And pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm not afraid to die.
may be seated.
Wow. Just wanted to just take this second. It feels kind of like a weird thing to talk about right now, besides just to give the Lord just the praise tonight, man. A lot of people's lives were changed. Just give them some, show them some love. I just want to share with you real quick, just if you guys, all of you got one of these hopefully when you came in. If you look on the flip side, backside, it's just a response form. And we really get encouraged, and we send these out to pastors, but we'd like you to take just a minute to fill them out. So grab a pencil if you don't have one, wait for the person next to you, and just start filling them out a little bit. And while that's happening, the ushers are going to come forward, so they're on their way up. What did you guys think of Josh McDowell? It's pretty cool, okay. So I'm guessing you guys enjoyed it, and I'll tell you what, I've never seen that many people respond to an altar call, so that was just a huge blessing. We're asking this. I know it was a different Jesus Fest this time because, you know, we asked for money at the door, but to bring in a guy like Josh, it cost a lot of money. But at the same time, we really got someone that could really deliver the message right to us. You know, the Holy Spirit definitely anointed him today as he spoke. So as the ushers are coming forward, we know a lot of you already gave $5 and that's maybe all you had, but we ask some of those of you that the Lord has really blessed financially to please bless this ministry. Crossfire is the one that brought him in. And man, you know what, can we just give just a shout of appreciation for what Crossfire did by bringing him in here. So as the ushers are coming forward, I just want you guys to seriously, just as I pray for the offertory, just to really search the Lord. Maybe some of you guys or ladies out there, some of you adults, just really, you know, want to support the ministry that you've seen going on today. So let's pray together. Father God, we thank you, Father, for the harvest that we got to witness before our own eyes, or we got to see you move in this place. And God, what is cooler than watching you come in and do open heart surgery on young people's lives. Father, on some of the adults' lives, Lord, on my life. God, I just ask that as these plates go down, Lord, we don't look at this as dollars and cents, but we look at this just as a response, saying, Lord, we are so appreciative of what you did today. So God, we love you, and we trust that you're gonna provide all that we ever need. In your precious name we pray, amen.
I am not afraid.
from my past to own more of my soul than I thought I had given away. They linger in closets and under my bed and in pictures less proudly displayed. A great fool in my life I have been. Take blame for the darkness I know I've let win. So turn on the light and reveal all the glory. I am not afraid to bear all my weakness, knowing in meekness I have a kingdom to gain. Where there is peace and love in the light, oh, I keep to myself all the safe and secure in the arms of a sinner I am.
Let's hear it again for Katie Allen. Praise God. We heard an awesome message today in church that reminds me of that, and how it's just awesome when the church uses its gifts and edifies one another. And it encourages me every day. So if you would stand up, we are going to end this fabulous evening with an awesome song, declaring that we are going to be salt and light in the world. Amen? Amen. All right. Feel free to jump in your seats or come up on stage, do whatever you want.
Holiness I will pursue. I want the heart of Jesus.
I want to give this world a taste of the love of Jesus. Make me salt, make me light. Let your holy fire ignite. Reveal your glory in my life. Cause I am not your holy name. Make me salt, make me light. You make me want to be like you. Your holiness I will pursue. I want the heart of Jesus. Show me the meaning of your grace. I want to give this world a taste of the love of Jesus. Make me salt, make me light. Let your holy fire ignite. Reveal your glory in my life. Cause I am not ashamed to lift up your holy name. Make me salt, make me light. Send me as a city on a hill. Lamp on the stand, mold me in your image, the work of your hands. Make me salt, make me light. Let your holy fire ignite. Reveal your glory in my life. Cause I am not ashamed. Your holy name. Make me salt, make me the heart of Jesus.
show me the meaning of your grace. I want to give this world a taste of the love of Jesus. Make me salt, make me light. Let your holy fire ignite. Reveal your glory in my life. A lamp on the stand, mold me in your image, the work of your hands. Make me salt, make me light, let your holy fire ignite, give you your glory. I am